Hello friends, so today we are going to talk about the applications of liquid crystal material, that is liquid crystal display. So as we have already talked about the liquid crystals, that there are how many types of liquid crystals, or what do you mean by liquid crystals? So when we talk about the liquid crystal display, it's the most widely used application of liquid crystals. Now, if you remember that in liquid crystals, we were talking about certain crystals which were in different phases. Like for example, the main common phases of liquid crystals which we talked about in the previous videos were about the nemetic phase, smetic phase and cholestric phase. So this is what we are going to use in today's application, that is liquid crystal display. Secondly, when you are talking about liquid crystal display, we are going to make use of light in that case. That is, obviously light is eventually applied or used in the case of liquid crystal display. So we need to talk about some properties of light before understanding the concept of liquid crystal display. So starting with the liquid crystal display, we need to understand that what is light. Now, when you say light, light is considered to be an electromagnetic wave. But when you say electromagnetic wave, it is going to consider electric field vector, that is E vector, and magnetic field vector. And when we talk about these two vectors, that is electric field vector and the magnetic field vector, they are perpendicular to each other. Secondly, they are even perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. So when we talk about light has an electromagnetic wave, we say that it consists of electric vector, that is E vector. It also consists of magnetic field vector, that is B vector. And we even have the direction of polarization of light or the propagation of light. So in this case, when you talk about light is an electromagnetic wave, in that case, we talk about E vector, B vector perpendicular to each other as well as perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. Now, when you talk about light, light can be an unpolarized light or we can have polarized light. What do you mean by polarized light and what do you mean by unpolarized light? What's the main difference between the unpolarized light and the polarized light? Now, when you say unpolarized light, suppose if I take a source of light and that source of light is emitting light, and in that light I said it is going to have an electric vector as well as magnetic field vector. So the source of light which we have considered, in that suppose electric vectors are vibrating in all the possible directions. So when we start with a certain source of light, that is the original source of light, in that light, when it is traveling in a form of wave, it will consist of electric vectors vibrating in all the directions. So if I show a diagram somewhat like this, that is double arrows which are oriented in all the different directions, this is indicating that the electric vectors which are present in the wave of light is vibrating in all the directions. And if a diagram is represented like this, that is electric vector is vibration in all the direction, that type of light is considered to be unpolarized light. So if there is a presence of vibration of electric vectors in the light in all the possible directions, then that light is considered to be unpolarized light. Now we need to polarize the light. Why? Because when we are studying about the concept of liquid crystal display, that is our topic, in that we need to understand what is polarization of light. So the basic idea behind the liquid crystal display is all about polarization of light. So first of all, we are going to understand what is polarization of light. So as you can say that, as electric vectors of the light is vibrating in all the possible directions, in that case, the light is considered to be unpolarized light. But suppose if I make use of a polarizer, this is indicating a polarizer made up of certain crystals. And there is a line passing through this polarizer. This line is nothing but called as crystallographic axis. So the line passing through the center of the polarizer is called as crystallographic axis. Now, if this unpolarized light is allowed to pass through this polarizer, what is going to happen is this polarizer is going to allow the light or only those electric vectors to pass through it whose vibrations are parallel to its crystallographic axis. So, as I said, before the polarizer, this is the polarizer. Before the polarizer, we have unpolarized light, that is electric vectors vibrating in all the possible directions. Now, what is the purpose of using this polarizer with a crystallographic axis is that this polarizer restricts the vibration of light, that is in the direction parallel to the crystallographic axis. So this polarizer which is present over here, that is P1, is going to allow only those electric vectors to pass through it whose vibrations are parallel to crystallographic axis. So as we can see that the electric vectors in these two diagrams is vibrating in all the directions, but once I use a polarizer after the unpolarized light, this polarizer will allow only those light vectors to pass which are having vibrations parallel to crystallographic axis. So I will have vibrations constrained in only one plane, that is the plane parallel to the crystallographic axis. So as we can see that this vibrations or this electric vectors are vibrating in only one direction parallel to the crystallographic axis. So if the electric vectors have the vibration parallel to crystallographic axis, those are allowed to pass through the polarizer. And as you can see that now the light is only going to possess electric vectors vibrating in only one direction, that is parallel to the crystallographic axis. So as you can see in the previous part, that is in the unpolarized light, the electric vectors were vibrating in all the directions. Hence, it is considered as unpolarized light. But after the polarizer, as the polarizer is used to polarize the light, I am able to see only those electric vectors which are vibrating in only one direction parallel to the crystallographic axis. So, if I restrict the direction of vibration of electric vectors, then we obtain polarized light. So what do you mean by polarization is that it is a phenomena of a restriction of vibration of electric vector in one plane or in one direction. So if I restrict the vibration of electric vectors in one direction instead of all the directions, then that is considered to be conversion of unpolarized light to polarized light. And if I do this conversion, the phenomena is going to be called as polarization of light. So as we can see that we have converted unpolarized light into polarized light using the phenomena of polarization. So please simply keep in your mind that what you mean by polarization is that restriction of vibration of electric vector in only one direction, that is parallel to crystallographic axis. And that's only possible using a material called as polarizer, and every polarizer will consist of a crystallographic axis, that is axis passing through the center. So we have converted unpolarized light into polarized using a polarizer. This phenomena is termed as polarization of light. Now, as I said in the previous part, that for the application of liquid crystal display, we require the polarization of light. Because if we understand the concept of polarization of light, the main concept behind the working of liquid crystal display. Now, let's come to the basic part of liquid crystal display. In this case, as you can see, when I'm talking about liquid crystal display, we are talking about the term called as polarization. As you can see in this particular diagram, this rays or this electromagnetic waves or this light is having directions or vibrations of electric vector in all the directions. That is, they are represented by blue color, this orange color, green color. What is this representing? it is representing electric vectors vibrating in all the possible directions. But as you can see, this unpolarized light is allowed to pass through a polarizing filter which has a vertical passage. So, as the unpolarized light has a vibration in all the possible directions, that is electric vectors having vibration in all the possible directions, is allowed to pass through this polarizing filter with a vertical passage. So, if it has only vertical passage, so only those vibrations are going to be passed through this filter that is vibrating vertically. So, as you can see that, the vibrations which are vibrating vertically is allowed to pass through the polarizing filter, thus converting the unpolarized light into polarized light, and we have restricted the vibration of electric vector in only one direction, that is vertical vibrations, and all the remaining directions are restricted. So this is the way we convert unpolarized into polarized. And secondly, when we are talking about this use of polarizer in conversion of unpolarized light to a polarized light, we have one more polarizer used in this particular phenomena. Like suppose if we have an unpolarized light present over here, after that we have placed a crystal which is acting as a polarizer, that is we can name it as polarizer P1, and after that I'm again placing a polarizer which is named as P2. So in this case we have presence of two polarizers. This direction is considered to be the direction of propagation of light. And secondly, when you talk about the remaining vibrations, like in this case, as I said, that there is an unpolarized light previously. So the electric vectors are vibrating in all the directions. But I have a crystallographic axis that is in a vertical plane. So this polarizer is going to allow only vertical vibrations through the itself. So I'm going to get a polarized light over here. That is, we have restricted the vibrations of electric vector of light. So we are getting polarized light. But after this polarized light, we have again placed one more polarizer. Now, if this electric vectors are vibrating in vertical plane, as you can see, this vibration is parallel to the crystallographic of the polarizer P2, then the light will be able to pass through it. But if we allow this polarizer P2 to rotate itself, that is, initially the polarizer P2 is like this, and the light electric vectors of the light are vibrating in the same direction or in the parallel direction to the crystallographic axis of polarizer P2. But now, when we allow the rotation of polarizer P2 in this case, so as the angle goes on becoming 90 degrees, now the polarizer is going to have crystallographic axis in horizontal direction, but my electric vector is in a vertical direction. So this vertical vibration is not going to be allowed through the horizontal crystallographic axis, and hence I won't get any light in this case. But if it further goes through the rotation, if it again becomes parallel to crystallographic axis, then again this vertical vibration is going to be allowed and we are going to get a certain intensity of light. So as we allow the rotation of polarizer P2, the intensity of light is varying. That means, as you can see in the whole diagram, polarizer P1 is just polarizing the light, means it is restricting the vibration of light in one direction. That's the purpose of using the polarizer P1. But once I get a polarized light, I make use of one more polarizer, that is P2. And what is the use of that polarizer P2 is that if I allow the rotation of this polarizer, this hand or this palm is behaving as polarizer P2. If I allow the rotation of this polarizer P2, as this polarizer P2 rotates, the intensity of light which is coming at the output changes. So if the polarizer becomes perpendicular to the vibration of the polarized light, I will receive no light in this region, that is at the output. And as the rotation changes again, and if the crystallographic axis of the polarizer becomes parallel to the vibration of the electric vector, then we are again going to get a light at the output. So we can say that P1 controls the polarization of light. P1 polarizer in this phenomena controls the polarization of light, that is unpolarized to polarized, and P2 polarizing controls the intensity of light. So we can allow the rotation of polarizer P2, and if we allow the rotation of polarizer P2, we can get a certain intensity of light at the output. So if the polarizer P2 is at perpendicular to the vibration of the electric vector, we are going to get no light at the output. But if they are parallel, then we are going to get a light at the output. So intensity of the light at the output is completely determined by second polarizer, that is P2, and whether I'm getting a polarized light or not, that is completely or entirely dependent on the polarizer P1. So this is the concept related to polarization of light, and we are basically discussing about polarization because this is the main concept behind the liquid crystal display. So this is overall the concept of polarization, that is we are making use of two polarizing filter, P1 and P2. One is used to polarize the light and the second one is used to control the intensity of light which is coming at the output. So if the polarizer P2 is orthogonal to the vibration of electric vector, we are going to receive no light at the output. But if they are parallel to each other, we are going to receive some light or maximum light at the output. So the intensity of light at the output can be controlled with the help of polarizer P2. And sometimes they are also named as analyzers, the one which controls the intensity of light at the output. And it decides whether I will get the light at the output or not. So using this concept of polarization, we can start with the concept of liquid crystal display. Now, first of all, what do you mean by liquid crystal display is that, obviously, everyone has seen what is liquid crystal display or the LCD TVs and all. In that case, we can just define it as a thin, because the flat size is very less, it is thin flat panel, and obviously, it is used for the displaying purpose. And obviously, the information which will be displayed electronically with the help of LCD will be nothing but the text, images, moving pictures. As we can see on the LCD TVs, we can see the moving pictures, we can see the text, we can see the images. So we can say that LCD is nothing but a thin flat panel which is going to be used for the display purpose, and obviously it can electronically display many information such as text. There we can show the display of images, we can display moving pictures. So this is what you mean by LCD, that is liquid crystal display. And secondly, as I said, liquid crystal display requires a polarization of light, the light which is passing through the material. Now obviously we are going to talk about the working of liquid crystal display, how the liquid crystal display is going to work. But in the just a rough diagram, as we can see in this liquid crystal display, at the back of the liquid crystal display, that is LCD instruments, we have light source present over there, and after that we have the presence of polarizing filter. Then we have electrodes present over there. We have two electrodes, one is the negative electrode and the other one is considered to be the positive electrode, and between the two electrodes there is a sandwich of liquid crystals, that is dynamatic crystal, or it can be cymatic crystal or crystallotic crystals. So you can have different types of crystals over there. So when you talk about this liquid crystal sandwiched between negative electrode and the positive electrode, the liquid crystals can be taken on the dependency like which one is more suitable. After this positive electrode, we have the presence of color filter in this region. After that, we have one more polarizing filter. And at the front part, which is visible to us, we have the display surface. So this is like overall mechanism or the construction of the liquid crystal display, that is LCDs. Like overall, every LCDs consist of this mechanism. So we can say that LCDs are going to have the panels of instrument together. And here, let's see, we are going to talk about each and every panels. We are going to talk about each and every purpose of each and every instruments used in LCDs. Before that, in the previous, like many years back, we used to make use of cathode ray tubes, that is the TVs which we used initially. They're bigger in size, and at the back of that TV we used to have the cathode ray tubes, which was used for the purpose of showing the moving pictures or text or images. So everything was controlled using the cathode ray tubes in the previous TVs, but now we make use of LCDs. So previously we were making use of cathode ray tubes, that is at the back of the TV there was a presence of instrument called as cathode ray tube. But right now we are talking about LCDs. So we can obviously compare LCDs and cathode ray tubes. Why we prefer LCDs over cathode ray tubes? So the first advantage is they are smaller in size. When you talk about LCDs, they cover 60% lesser space as compared to the cathode ray tubes. When you talk about in terms of power consumption, obviously, when you say that cathode ray tubes consume a certain amount of power, about half of the power consumed by cathode ray tubes is consumed by the LCDs. So LCDs have the ability to consume less power, and it is emitting less heat, or it is not so heated up as compared to the cathode ray tubes. So the power consumed is half of that consumed by the cathode ray tubes in terms of LCDs. Obviously, when you talk about the weight of LCDs in the cathode ray tubes, this is the obvious answer, that whenever we talk about the weight of LCD with the cathode ray tubes were very larger in size. So about 70% weight is lesser for LCD as compared to the cathode ray tubes. When you talk about no electromagnetic fields, there is no presence of electromagnetic field in LCDs, and that is there was a presence of electromagnetic fields in the cathode ray tubes, which was not at all required in LCDs. And lastly, they have longer life than the cathode ray tubes. So these are like the main purpose, or you can say the main advantages, that why we use LCDs over cathode ray tubes. Now coming to the crystals, as I said, we are talking about applications of liquid crystal, that is liquid crystal display. So when we are studying about the liquid crystal display, the liquid crystals which are used in that, it is also important. So the most common type of crystals which are used in liquid crystal display are the two, that is nemetic phase and the smetic phase. But if you ask me, out of the two, which one is most preferred, is that it is the nemetic phase of the crystal which is mostly preferred in the liquid crystal display. So whenever we make an LCD, we try to prefer two crystals, that is in the nemetic phase and the smetic phase. But the most preferred crystal is the nemetic phase, and that is also particularly the twisted nemetic phase. Now as you talk about the liquid crystal concept, I said we are going to mostly prefer nemetic crystals. And when you say liquid crystals, in that case, liquid crystals are the phase of matter which are in between solid and liquid state. So they flow like liquid, but they have the orientation according to the crystals. So when you compare liquid crystal with solid and liquid, we can say that liquid crystal has the property of flowing as compared to the liquid, but they have the orientation as compared to the crystals, that is solid. So that is why we say that liquid crystal is a phase of matter which lies between solid and the liquid phase. Secondly, when you talk about nemetic phase of the liquid crystal, which is used in LCDs, we prefer twisted nemetic phase, or you can say twisted nemetic crystals. So the most popularly used crystals are twisted nematic crystals in the nematic part. And if you look at this second diagram, this is indicating that if you have an unpolarized light that is allowed to flow through the polarizing filter, and if the unpolarized light is allowed to pass through the polarizing filter, the unpolarized light will get converted into polarized light. And after that, this polarized light is allowed to pass through the crystals, that is twisted nematic crystals. And depending upon the orientation of twisted nematic crystals, it will depend whether I'm going to get the light at the output or whether I'm not going to get any light at the output. So we can say that first of all, in the LCD structure, we polarize the light which is coming from the back. That is, we try to convert unpolarized light into polarized using the polarizing filter. Then we try to orient the molecules of the twisted nematic crystal, and depending upon the orientation of the nematic crystal, the orientation of the polarizing light will be changed, and accordingly I will get the output, that is a certain intensity of light at the output or no intensity of light at the output. So that is entirely dependent on the orientation of the twisted nematic crystal. So we can say that whether I'm going to get light at the display or whether I'm not going to get any light at the display of the LCD, that is entirely dependent on the orientation of the liquid crystals which are present in between these filters. So continuing with the further part, if you look at the whole mechanism or the instrument of this particular LCDs, at the back we have the source of light which is acting as a backlight. So from that source of light, a white light is allowed to pass through it. Then we have diffuser. Why is diffuser used? It is used for distributing the light evenly throughout the whole viewing area. So the backlight is nothing but a source of a fluorescent lamp. This fluorescent lamp acts as a source of light, which is a backlight. And once the backlight is moved in the forward direction, mostly it is considered to be the white light, it is allowed to pass through the diffuser. And what is the purpose of using the diffuser over there is that whatever light is coming over there is distributed evenly throughout the viewing area. That purpose is done by the diffuser. Then we have the rear polarizer, that is the polarizing filter at the back. And after that, we have the presence of TFT matrix. Now, when you say TFT matrix, what do you mean by TFT matrix is that it is a thin film transistor matrix. And after that, we have the layer of liquid crystal. Then we have the presence of Kölner filters. So the liquid crystal layer is present between the color filter and the TFT matrix. What is TFT matrix? It is a thin film transistor matrix. And ultimately, whatever light is coming from the backlight is allowed to pass through the color filter, regaining the colors. Like, why we make use of color filters is that color filters are you going to give me the colors for the different pixels, or you can say colors to the light which is coming from the backward, that is the backlight. And ultimately, whatever light is or whatever images we want to display at the screen is allowed to pass through the front polarizer. So as we are talking about the instruments which are used in LCDs, in that case we said that the backlight is going to emit the white light, and that white light is allowed to pass through the diffuser. This diffuser is going to have the tendency to distribute the light evenly throughout the viewing area. Then we have the rear polarizer, which is at the back, that is the polarizer which is just placed in front of the diffuser. And obviously, at that particular polarizer, the unpolarized light coming from the backlight will get polarized. Then that polarized light is allowed to pass through this TFT matrix. And through that TFT matrix, we can provide the electric field. And after that, we have the presence of liquid crystal layer, which is going to consist of the nematic crystals, which is most preferably used crystals. So this is what you talk about, the nematic liquid crystals, which are present in the liquid crystal layer. And after that, we have the presence of color filter. Color filter is going to consist of color filters, which generate colors, different colors according to our requirement. And after that, at the display, we have the presence of one more polarizer, which will control the intensity of light. And we are going to get the ultimate display of images, text at the front display, that is, which is seen from the LCDs. Now, when you talk about the different parameters present over there, we can apply the voltage between the two instruments. That is, if we control the voltage between the TFT matrix and the color filter, this applied voltage controls the movement of the liquid crystal which is placed in the liquid crystal layer. So the applied voltage between the TFT matrix and the color filter will change the orientation of the liquid crystals which are present in the liquid crystal layer. Secondly, the amount of light which is emitted or which is given out by the backlight is determined by the amount of movement of the crystals which is used to generate the colors. So when you talk about the amount of light which is coming from the backlight, is completely determined by the amount of movement of the crystals according to the color which we want at the output. So this is what we talk about, the each and every instruments which are used in the LCDs, and each and every instrument purpose which are being used in the LCD display. Next is, as you can see in this diagram, this is like one more side view of the LCD. This at the end, we have the white unpolarized light from a backlight, which is allowed to pass through a rear glass. This glass has no functions. It is just allowed to pass the white light through the rear glass. Then we have the polarizing filter where the unpolarized light gets polarized. And after that polarizing filter, we have the liquid crystals which are present in between the two polarizing filters. Then we have the presence of color filter, which is used to generate the different colors. Then we have placed one more polarizing film at the front. And again, the front glass, which is able to be visible from the front, that is the front glass, which is at the display. And this is going to give me the white light coming from the backlight is going to get emerged out of this final display and will give the colors which is required by the input. So this is how the working looks like. Secondly, as I said, the liquid crystal orientation will decide whether I will get the intensity of the light at the output or not. So like, for example, whenever we talk about liquid crystals, we are making use of nematic liquid crystals, and basically the crystals which are used, they are twisted nematic crystals. So normally the twisted nematic crystals are twisted at the angle of 90 degrees. So in this case, as you can see in the first diagram, the liquid crystals are twisted at 90 degrees, and the source of light is present over here. The light is allowed to pass through this, that is unpolarized light is allowed to pass through this first polarizer. This polarizer, the first polarizer, will polarize the light depending upon whether it has a vertical polarization or a horizontal polarization. So the unpolarized light coming from the source of light is allowed to pass through the polarizer. Now, whatever be the orientation of the polarizer, like whether it is a vertical or the horizontal, I'm going to get a polarized light after the polarizer. Then, as we can see, when there is no voltage applied between the two polarizers or the two electrodes, that is the negative electrode and the positive electrode, in that case, the nematic crystals are going to be twisted at the 90 degrees. So the basic arrangement of the LCD is that we have the light source, we have polarizing film, we have two electrodes, that is negative and the positive electrode. In between the two electrodes, we have placed the liquid crystal, and After the positive electrode, we have again a polarizer and the output. So if an unpolarized light is allowed to pass through the polarizer, it will polarize the light, that is, it will restrict the vibration of light in only one direction. Then if I'm not applying any voltage between the negative electrode and the positive electrode, in that case, these crystals are going to be twisted at 90 degree. So the nemetic crystals, which are present in the crystal layer, are twisted at 90 degree with no electric field applied to it, no voltage applied to it. So if no voltage is applied between the electrodes, the liquid crystal, that is nemetic crystals, are twisted at 90 degree. So now once the polarized light is allowed to pass through this crystal, as the crystals are twisted at 90 degree, the crystals will shift the polarization of light according to themselves. So whatever light is coming, suppose the light is, that is a polarized light, is coming in the vertical vibration. So if the liquid crystals are oriented in this manner, that is like this, that is twisted in this manner, and the polarized light is vibrating in the vertical plane. So once this polarized light, which is vibrating in the vertical plane, comes to the liquid crystal, this twisted liquid crystal will shift the polarization of light. That is, as the liquid crystals were like this, oriented like this, so it will twist or it will change the polarization of light which has come to it. So now, as you can see that this light is now polarized or vibrating in the horizontal direction. Now this can pass through the crystal, as the crystal alignment has shifted the polarization of light. Now the light which is moving forward is going to have the horizontal vibration. Now after that, we have placed one more polarizer, and this polarizer has horizontal sections. So now the light which is moving has a vertical horizontal polarization, because the twisted nemetic crystal has shifted the polarization from vertical to horizontal. So now this horizontal light, or the light which is vibrating in the horizontal section, can pass through the second polarizer, giving me a certain intensity of light at the output. But what happens when I apply a certain voltage between the two electrodes? Like, this is the source of light, this is the polarizer, first polarizer, this is your negative electrode, this sheet is acting as the positive electrode, and this is again the polarizer. Now in this case, suppose this polarizer has vertical polarization and this polarization has horizontal polarization. So in that case, the light source which is, or the light which is coming from the source, is initially unpolarized, that is, vibrations are present in all the directions. So what is this first polarization going to do is that it is going to restrict the vibration of light in the vertical direction. Now after the first polarizer, I have the vibration of light in the vertical direction. Now as you can see, we have applied an AC voltage between the two electrodes. That means we have applied electric field to the, or we have given, or we are subjecting this electrodes to the electric field. This means that we are subjecting the liquid crystals to an external electric field. Now once I subject this liquid crystal to an external electric field, this twisted nemetic crystals are going to get untwisted. So what is the concept is that if I don't apply an external voltage, or if I don't apply an external electric field or magnetic field, the crystals are going to be twisted at 90 degree. But if I apply an external voltage, or apply an electric field or magnetic field, the crystals which are twisted initially will get untwisted. Now if they are twisted in this manner till 90 degree, as the polarized light is vibrating in the vertical direction, the crystals are twisted in this manner. Now apply external electric field. Because of the external electric field, the twisted crystals will now become untwisted. So as you can see that vibration of light, and because of the untwisting of light, you can see that we are not going to allow the light to pass through it. And once the light is not passing through it, we are going to get no light at the output. That means we can change the orientation of the liquid crystal depending upon the external field which we are applying. So if we are not applying any external field, the liquid crystals are going to be twisted. But if we apply an external field to a liquid crystal, the twisted crystals will get untwisted, and hence they are not going to allow the light to pass through the second polarizer, and we are going to get the dark screen at the output. So that means whether if I'm getting a light at the output or not, that is completely dependent on the orientation of the liquid crystals. So we can say that the intensity of the light which I'm getting at the output, that is at this case or this case, as you can see, there is no light obtained over here. So the intensity of light which is obtained at the output is completely dependent on orientation of liquid crystals between the electrodes. So if I don't apply any electric field to the crystals are going to be twisted at 90 degrees, and hence they will allow the light to pass through them and even through the second polarizer, and we are going to get the light at the output. That is the first case. Second, if I have two polarizers, one is at vertical polarization, the other one is having horizontal, and if I apply electric field to the liquid crystals, the twisted liquid crystals will become untwisted and they will allow the light to pass through it, but the second polarizer will not allow the light. So we are not going to get the light at the output. So the intensity of light at the output is completely dependent on orientation of the liquid crystals, and we can even say that orientation of liquid crystals is entirely dependent on whether we are applying the electric field to it or not. So we have to keep in mind that whenever electric field is applied, the twisted nematic crystals will get untwisted, and when we talk about no electric field, in case of no electric field, we can say that the liquid crystals, or we can say the nematic liquid crystals, are twisted at 90 degrees. So the orientation of the liquid crystal is entirely dependent on the electric field applied to it. So as we can see in the next diagram, that we have two polarizing filters, that is one that is a vertical polarization filter and the second is the horizontal polarizing filter. And in the initial case, we can see that there is an unpolarized light, and unpolarized light means the vibration of light in all the direction. Now, what is this vertical polarization filter doing? Is restricting the vibration of unpolarized light in only one direction, that is vertical. Now, the light which is entering this liquid crystal molecule is having a vertical vibration or vertical orientation. Now, if I don't apply, in this case, if I don't apply the electric field to the liquid crystals, as you can see, if no field is applied, the liquid crystals are twisted. And as we again close the switch, liquid crystals get oriented. So that is entirely dependent that whether we apply the electric field. If there is no electric field, in that case, the crystals are twisted at 90 degrees. But as soon as we close the switch, the crystals get aligned. Now, depending upon whether the orientation of liquid crystals, we are going to get a certain output of light or not. So if the liquid crystals are twisted, as we can see that if the liquid crystals in the first case are twisted, I was getting a light at the output. But as soon as you switch it off, or as soon as you switch, close the switch, in that case, the liquid crystals get aligned and we get no light output. Depending upon the orientation of the liquid crystals, that is entirely dependent on the electric field applied to it, we get output of the light after the second horizontal polarized filter, or if the electric field is not applied to it, the crystals are going to be twisted, and if they are twisted, we are going to get the light at the output. So the basic mechanism is same, completely dependent on the polarization of light. There is one more parameter, something called as pixels. Now, what do you mean by pixels in this that? Now, when you say the TFT matrix or the liquid crystal display, in that liquid crystal display, we say that all the polarization of light or the intensity of light which is getting at the output is completely dependent on the orientation of the liquid crystals. So we can say that there is an array of small regions present on the liquid crystals which are called as pixels. So we can say that pixels are nothing but the arrays of small regions in which the molecules can be oriented. So the small regions which are present on the liquid crystals, that small regions are termed as pixels. Now, whenever you say the small regions in which the orientation of the molecules can be changed in the liquid crystal is called as pixel. Now, we are aware of the word called as pixel. Like most of all, like in all the electronic devices, like whether we talk about LCDs, whether we talk about the mobile phones, or whether we talk about any other electronic device, we choose the device or camera depending upon the pixels of that liquid crystal display. That means if the pixels is very high, the camera is going to have higher resolution, and if the pixels are less, the resolution is going to be low. So that means resolution of any display or resolution of any camera is completely dependent on the pixels. What is pixels? The smaller regions which are present on the liquid crystal, and in that small regions we can orient the crystal molecules. So that small regions are referred to be pixels. So if I have a liquid crystal which has large number of pixels present on it, we can say that it is going to give me high resolution. High resolution in images, that is, we are aware that if a particular resolution is HD resolution, so in that case the number of pixels are high. If it is a normal resolution, the number of pixels are less. So we have to keep in mind that pixels are nothing but the small regions of the liquid crystals in which the orientations of the molecule can be manipulated, and that small regions are termed as pixels. And depending upon the number of pixels, we can decide the resolution. If more the number of pixels, higher will be the resolution of the cameras or the LCDs. Lesser number of pixel, or the lesser number of pixel per unit area, the resolution of the images or the display or the material or the cameras is going to be less. So we can say that pixels decides the resolution of the display. And when you say in which manner it is deciding the resolution, so we can say that resolution is directly proportional to the number of pixels per unit area. So if we have more number of pixels present per unit area, higher will be the resolutions, and lesser number of pixels per unit area will give me lesser resolutions. So this is what you all talk about, the way of getting the display of images or display of text or display of moving pictures on the LCD screens. And this is what you talk about, the pixels are controlling the resolutions of the images. Secondly, the liquid crystals orientations are controlling the pixels, whether they are going to be on or off. Depending upon it, we are going to get the colors, that is red color, blue color, or different colors which we want. And next is when you talk about displays. Like, we can have two types of displays. That is, one is reflective display and the backlight display. Sometimes, like, all the LCDs, they don't have their own light. They are illuminated from a source of light. So when we talk about LCDs, they don't have their own light. They are supposed to be illuminated from an external source. So if an external source is attached at the back, that is, it is considered to be the backlight. In that case, it is called as the backlight display. But if the source of light or the light coming from the source is reflected from a reflector, and the light which is getting reflected from a reflector is used for the display, that is considered to be the reflective display. So we can have two types of displays in LCDs or in liquid crystal display, is that reflective and the backlight. As we are aware that LCDs are not going to have their own light. They are supposed to be illuminated from an external source. So if we display or if we illuminate with an external source connected at the backlight, it is considered as a backlight display. But if the light coming from the external source is supposed to be reflected from the reflector and it is used for the display purpose, then it is considered to be the reflective display. So we can either have backlight display or the reflective. As we can see that I've shown a three diagrams, that is transmissive, reflective and transflective. In that case, this one is indicating that reflective means the light coming from the source is reflected from the reflector and then that light goes to the display. And in the backlight case, the light is immediately coming from the back source, that is behind the polarizer, and from there the display is getting illuminated. So this is the two types of displays which we can have, that is reflective and the backlight display. Next is, as I said that in LCDs we most preferably use the twisted nematic crystals, and obviously on the orientation of the twisted nematic crystal, it depends that whether I'm going to get a certain intensity of light or not. So if the crystals are twisted at the 90 degree, and if no field is applied, we get a light at the output. If the crystals are twisted, but if I apply an electric field to it, the twisting of the crystals get affected and they get untwisted and I get no light at the output. So, and as we can see that the polarizers which are kept on the either sides of the liquid crystals, they are orthogonal to each other, that is at 90 degree with each other, which is obviously required for polarization of light, so that we can get a certain intensity of light at the output or not. So in the first case, if the crystals are twisted with no electric field, I'm going to get a certain colors of the pixel. But if we apply the electric field and we get the untwisting of the twisted nematic crystal because of the applied electric field, I will get no light at the display. That means the pixels are going to be dark. But they appear to be dark because the pixels are in the off state. In this case, the pixels are in on state. So if I'm not getting any light at the display, they are considered to be the pixels in the dark state, or you can say they are in the off state. That is no light. That is, you can say the black light. So depending upon whether the orientation of the twisted nematic crystals, we can get different colors. Or you can say the pixels are off, giving me the dark pixel or the dark light or the black light. Next is, when you talk about the types of LCDs, we can talk about the passive matrix display and the active matrix display. In this case, what is the main differentiation between the passive and the active one is that in passive matrix display, the pixels are resolved, or you can say they are resolved at one at a time, first of all, and secondly, the in passive the resolution is very much low. That means in passive matrix display, each pixel is addressed one at a time. That is one row, one column matrix. So each pixels in the passive matrix is addressed one at a time. As the exposure time, or you can say the exposure time, is very less, so the number of pixels which are on is very much lesser. So if the number of pixels are less, the resolution is going to be low. So in the passive matrix display, we can say that pixels are addressed one at a time. So the process is very slow, and if the process of addressing the pixel is slow, so the number of pixels are going to decrease. And if the number of pixels are less, this is going to give me low resolution images. But when you come to the active matrix display, in this case, the pixels are addressed sequentially. And if the pixels are addressed sequentially, in that case, we are going to get more pixels per unit area. And if I get more pixels per unit area, in that case, we are going to get high resolution and the response time is very high. So when you compare the two types of LCDs with each other, that is the passive and the active, we prefer active matrix over the passive matrix display because of many reasons, that is of the size, about the response time, about the higher resolution, higher number of pixels. So we try to prefer active matrix display over the passive matrix display. Lastly, when you're talking about the color display, as I said, there are color filters present in the instrument, and that color filters has the presence of pixels, and each pixel consists of three subpixels, that is of color red, green and blue. So every pixels have three subpixels, that is red, green and blue. Now when I take a different combinations or different intensities of the subpixels, that is red, green and blue, it is enough to give me the perceptions of all the different colors which are present in the whole spectrum of color. So basically color filters consist of only three colors, that is red, green and blue. And if I make use of different intensities of these three subpixels, I'm going to get different intensities of the whole spectrum of color. That is, our eye is going to have the perception of all the colors which are present in the spectrum with the help of just using the three colors, red, green and blue. So every color filters consist of only three subpixels, that is red, green and blue. And if I make use of different intensities of these three subpixels, I'm going to get different perceptions of whole spectrum of color. Like for example, if one subpixel, like if suppose red subpixel is giving me around 256 different intensities of color. Similarly, green will give me 256 different intensities of different colors in the spectrum. And similarly, blue will give me 256 different intensities of colors. So overall, we can get about 16 million palettes of pixels or colors, 16 million colors which are can be seen on the display with the help of only three colors, that is red, green and blue. So these three subpixels are the most sub important pixels which are used for obtaining the different intensities, that is around 16 million colors on the display. So with the help of only three subpixels, we can obtain 16 million colors at the display. So this is the way we obtain the color display at the LCDs. So when you talk about the LCD, that is liquid crystal display, this working is completely dependent on the number of pixels. And secondly, it depends on the polarization of light, which is done with the help of the polarizing filter. And everything, or that is polarization of light, or the intensity of light which is obtained at the output, is completely dependent on orientation of the nematic crystals, that is twisted nematic crystals, which is used in the liquid crystal display. So we can say that LCD basically works on main parameters, that is number of pixels, or you can say the polarization of light which is occurring over there, and the orientation of the liquid crystal molecules in the nematic phase, that is in the twisted nematic phase. So that is all you talk about the application of liquid crystal as liquid crystal display. That's all for this video. Thank you so much.